how to enter destination wedding market as a photographer?
How do you make them comfortable? So what are like hidden myths as a wedding photographer shooting destination weddings?
The secret behind to get your first destination wedding.
Coming up, chat with Ramit, where we discuss different aspects of his destination wedding photography style and his thoughts. Make sure you check the timestamps to all the questions I asked in the description. So let's begin.
Hi Ramit.
Hi Navdeep, thank you for having me here.
So Ramit, why not introduce yourself?
I have been a wedding photographer since the last 12 years. We got into wedding films and photography pretty early. I think when India was just transitioning into learning about candid photography, and I think we were one of the few people who were actually shooting weddings in a candid way. So I had a very photojournalistic style when I started, and from there to now, which is taking up complete weddings, including those what we call traditional pictures or group shots and the regular posed ones. In the last 4 or 5 years, I have been focusing on destination weddings. So primarily my work has been destination weddings. I think 80% of my weddings have been out of the cities and banquets. So now we focus on the really big weddings. Our average duration for weddings in the last 2 years has been between 5 and 7 days. And that has kind of become our forte, and people get us for those big fat weddings. I think it's just like they say, what you focus on, what you want to show the world is what they will get you for. So if you showcase them some fabulous destination pictures, people will get you as a destination photographer and not for like a wedding in a banquet or in a hotel.
True. Okay, so tell me, like, you would consider yourself as a techie photographer or more of a moment photographer? Like, I am a person who tends to shoot more of a moments, you know, rather than going the technicality of whether it's the cameras or lighting or equipment. Like, equipment is secondary for me. I guess the main is the people for me. So what is your way of thinking in terms of wedding photography?
So I have a typical concept of, you know, when we want to deliver a wedding, we want to sort of do a very storytelling style of capturing that entire wedding. So it has to include moments, it has to include portraits, it has to include family pictures. So right now I am in that zone that we focus on like the bigger picture. And while personally I do photojournalistic work during the wedding, and I also sort of specialize in taking those crazy portraits, or you know, those ambient portraits, or what we call destination portraits. And other than that, I have my team focus on the group shots, the coverage of that entire wedding. So it's more of a mix of everything. How to sort of get the lighting uniform, so that, you know, we have 5-6 different cameras working. We want to make sure that when it comes to the edit table, there is not much big difference in all the pictures. In terms of films as well, I sometimes we are shooting on different cameras. I generally like to sort of keep updated on the technical side. Also, I work very closely with Nikon and Godox. So yes, I would say I am a technical photographer. At the same time, right now, you know, the kind of weddings that we're doing, it's not just about moments, it's about everything that is happening in the wedding. But now it has become, you know, especially 2,000 guests coming in a wedding, or maybe a Jodhpur wedding, which has 3 different events going on at the same time. So, you know, it has to do with a mix of both technical and how you want to capture and showcase that wedding.
Okay, so tell me, do you use modifiers? Are you a person who is fond of like magmod or using gels or bending light in a very creative way? Because I know there was a trend going on a couple of years back, you know, like wedding photography, it has to be about, you know, using gels and magmods, right? Even if, like, I understand people are shooting all sorts of images, but there was a trend, you know, that you have to share all your magmod images.
Right. So I think that trend is not gone anywhere. People are still crazy about mag mods and you know, any modifier. Basically, any photographer that is doing well in the world, we want to copy him. And that is kind of the trend these days. That is always going to be the trend. There were times when people used to follow us, and then, you know, there were people who would do something different, and that following quickly changes to that person. So that keeps moving around. I think who we follow keeps changing, and who we follow also defines the kind of equipment that we want. Like, I'm just sitting here with you know, I'm sitting here with flashes, and Grace, I was just talking about how to use that. So I am a big fan of using all these things. These are technically not mag mods, but this is what Godox is making these days. So I generally use whatever new tech is there. It's you know, it just ups your game. It just allows you to do so much more. So yeah, it is a trend. I think that trend is going to stay for a couple of years more, unless something new comes up and some new lighting technique comes in.
Yeah, what I have seen is that a lot of Indian photographers, they are getting inspired or actually copying what the Western photographers are doing, right? They are replicating even the frame by frame, you know, even the poses, the lighting, or, you know, tweaking a little bit into it and then creating their own images. But a lot of upcoming photographers, they don't understand that these sort of pictures make even less than 1% of your entire, you know, wedding pictures.
See, I think what we are right now, what we are going through is the Instagram era, and a lot of photographers are, you know, hired solely based on their Instagram profiles. If you look at their 10 pictures, which are magnificent, but when you look at their 1,000 picture set, it is below average. So I think that is what we are going through. Coming from an era where, you know, we used to deliver 200 or 300 pictures of an entire wedding. So, you know, we used to make sure those 300 pictures are amazing and not just 5 or 10 pictures. And slowly this trend changed into just having 10 good pictures, and the remaining can just be basic coverage. So I think clients are also very smart, especially, you know, when we get hired for the big weddings, they want to sort of look at a larger set of pictures and then decide whether they want to go ahead with us or not, and not just those 8 or 10 pictures on Instagram. So, you know, that copying can only limit to those 8 or 10 or 12 pictures. What you do with the remaining 950 pictures is what actually defines your portfolio.
Correct. And a lot of upcoming photographers are actually missing the part you have just mentioned, because it is just not about your Instagram portfolio. You know, you have to have a wholesome portfolio when you are dealing with the actual client. You need to show them more pictures, because there will be very few clients who would just see your Instagram and then they will just hire you. Unless until you are a renowned name, you already have made a brand for yourself, and people, you know, there's a trust factor. You know, when people would say Ramit Batra, you know, there's a certain sort of a trust factor will be there. When somebody is coming to Navdeep, there is a trust factor there. Then obviously, you know, you can show a certain, even an Instagram would work. But as an upcoming photographer, you need to have a wholesome portfolio.
I think I would sort of defer to sort of what you are saying. I think it's pretty much the opposite of what happens. When you're a more well-known or more renowned name in the industry, people want to look at more of your work and be super sure that, you know, they are not just being misled by those 10 or 15 pictures. The newcomers who are coming here, they get hired on the go because of their 8 and 10 pictures. Firstly, because most of them have a very competitive pricing. So the client feels that, okay, you know, they are upcoming, they are promising. If they can make these 8 or 10 pictures look good, you know, they want to keep that gray area on. They don't want to go into a zone where they look at the entire set and they're like, oh, this is below average, but ye badi achhi thi, you know, what do we do with it? So I think more for whenever people have made a decision to hire us, they, you know, after choosing to go ahead with us, they've asked us to sort of showcase more of our work, you know, so that they can connect to what they like and what they want to go ahead with. Rather than, you know, in earlier days when people would just look at our website and blog post and they'll be like, hey, this is amazing, we would like to hire you. I think in the first 4 or 5 years, it was primarily based on the blog and the website and word of mouth. Right now, even the clients who have seen us work in a different wedding, they would come to us when they come to us in a meeting, they would ask us to sort of showcase more of our work.
Yeah, because the kind of clients which are coming to you will be very different from, let's say, the kind of clients that will be approaching most of the newbie photographers or who have been to the industry for an year or two, right? Because everyone wants to grow in their business, in their craft. And then, you know, they want to learn from experienced photographer, you know, what kind of experience they had. Like you mentioned, you know, yes, I still remember delivering 300, 400 pictures from a wedding used to be a norm, which was very sufficient. But I know a lot of people listening to this right now that, oh, Ramit was, you know, handing over just 200-300 images. But it was a reality, actually. They wanted only the quality pictures. They were not looking at the quantity. But right now, clients have a very different expectations, and lot of people take time to understand, you know, okay, what the market is presumably is looking at, and what actual the real clients are looking at. Because a lot of will be freelancers working for other photographers, they never get to deal with the real clients, you know. That also makes a lot of difference. And the price segment. See, a certain price segment will have different sort of an expectations. A lower end price segment will have a very different expectations. Like, you have Instagram profile with you, you have your website with you, you know, you can always redirect to them even on phone call. You know, you can go through this link, you can go through our Instagram page, you will have a wide variety. You can have a quick view with Instagram, and you can have a detailed view of your portfolio from your website. Okay, Ramit, so tell us from your experience, according to you, what newbie photographers or upcoming photographers, the kind of mistakes they are making, or, you know, you might have made mistakes and probably realized after a few years, you know, okay, this was not the way to start, or maybe I could have done things a little differently initially.
So I think the biggest mistake that people make is they get overconfident with their work very early. I think everybody has gone through that phase. I myself has experienced that. I think in the first 2 or 3 or 4 years, I had done a lot of weddings. I got featured in a lot of magazines and newspapers. And so I started feeling that, okay, you know, this has become bulletproof, and, you know, we can probably start choosing and picking on the clients that we want to work with. So, and that is when you sort of start thinking of increasing your price point. So that kind of became like a downfall for our business for a couple of years, because our clients were used to a certain price bracket that we used to work in. So maybe, you know, when we increase the price to maybe 30-40% more than that, they suddenly were astonished that, you know, that you did my sister's wedding at an X price. How can you charge 2x now, even if there was a gap of about 4 years or 5 years into that? So, you know, a gradual price increase is sort of not taken well by clients. So a jump in price was definitely not taken well at all. So we lost a lot of clients which would have come to us eventually because we had shot in their families. Secondly, not adjusting to the market trends. I started doing video in 2008 and 2009, and you know, when I started my first few weddings, I used to do video that time. In about 2011, you know, since it became very cool to just be a candid photographer and not be a studio, I sort of went with that trend and I stopped doing video. And so, you know, those 3 years, we lost a lot of clients who would say that, you know, we want complete coverage, and we'll be like, no, we don't do complete coverage. We just do candid photography. You can hire somebody for your traditional or whatever the other stuff. So again, we lost a lot of business there. So what I'm coming to is either you make your own style. Like, a lot of photographers right now are very particular that they do not offer video services. And there are other studios whose business model is that they only work alone and they only provide a complete coverage style. Just figure out what you want to do and not keep shuffling between, you know, today I want to do photos and videos, tomorrow I just want to do photos. Secondly, when it comes to pricing, just stick to that pricing for a couple of years.
With the current scenario, you know, current market not related to COVID, but how to enter destination wedding market as a photographer?
See, I think the current market is going to get affected by COVID, and we are fearing the whole thing a lot because destination weddings are not going to happen. Everybody is going to get choosy about just picking a banquet very close to their house or a farmhouse and just going ahead with it. So I'm assuming that we are not going to look into that scenario. That is probably going to stay for the next 6 to 12 months. Which is going to be difficult for us who focus on destination weddings. So let us just ignore that. Let us assume that everything has come back to normal and somebody wants to get into destination wedding photography. I think there are two things that a destination wedding photographer needs to focus on. One is environmental photographs. You should be able to capture a wedding or a event or a portrait and showcase a good destination, be it you know, as small as something like a pre-wedding shoot in a Lodi garden, or something as massive as a Thailand wedding or a 14-day wedding in Umaid Bhavan. So those kind of things will only come when you start showcasing that. Right now, the current trend is to showcase a lot of portraits, a lot of, like you said, magmod kind of work, harsh lighting. I know photographers who, even if they go to a beautiful destination, because they are stuck in that trend, they end up using harsh lighting and they just want to showcase their photography skills versus, you know, what the destination is capable of. So once you start showcasing that, people will get you for weddings which are, you know, in even in banquets, they'll be like, you know, we don't have a good destination, but this guy is able to make so much better pictures in whatever the environment is. So they will start getting you for those. So you have to set your own trend, I feel. If you want to get into destination weddings, you have to show environmental pictures. Secondly, you have to showcase destinations. So if you are not showing pictures of destinations or travel pictures or travel portraits, people do not understand how well you are going to do in a destination wedding. So I think those are the two primary factors. With Instagram, if you start posting those two things, I think that should do the work.
Any apps or wedding planning websites, they could offer any leads to enter into destination market? Should I go to this XYZ app and, you know, take a package? What is the secret behind to get your first destination wedding?
See, I would say there is no secret. It is just about shooting weddings in a slightly more airy style. Like, there are certain photographers who do a tremendous job, you know, using those magmods, using the decor of that banquet and combining it into looking like it is larger than life. And that is the exposure that people will get you for the bigger destination weddings, because they will foresee that, okay, my destination is 20 times more beautiful than this picture. And if I get this photographer there, this guy is going to kill it. So that is the only sort of mindset that you want to put to people. In terms of portals, what I've seen is, from what I've heard from other people, there are certain portals which are great for very low budget kind of inquiries. So if you want to focus on getting into the market, if you are not getting a lot of business, you should probably do the research and figure out what portals are working for whom. Probably whoever is your competitor, if he's able to crack some weddings out of that portal, then probably you can also try to invest in that portal. Honestly, once you have done the first 10 weddings, it becomes redundant. You don't need a portal. I think your portfolio and word of mouth is more important than being visible on any portal or any other website.
Maybe I'll also agree on that, because going to any wedding portal, maybe you are starting out, you have done one or two weddings, you know, you are not looking to earn a major chunk of money from the photography, you know, maybe work at a lower end of the, you know, your pricing, probably then it might work. But I don't see that you could get big weddings or destination weddings from, you know, any wedding app, because practically that destination wedding market really don't go into, you know, portals to find, you know, destination wedding photographers.
Right. You're right. So people who go on the portals are the people who don't have access to the resources, or they don't have time. So, you know, somebody who's sitting in the US and he's like, I have no idea what the Indian vendors look like, and, you know, I can't trust. So they'll go to a portal and they'll quickly search some things, and they'll be like, okay, my wedding is happening in, you know, a banquet in Chhatarpur, and my parents have booked this place and everything, but I want to, you know, get a few vendors. So they probably will get a couple of vendors, like a photographer, videographer, maybe a makeup artist and the mehndi artist, or a dhol wala. But they will never hire somebody like a wedding planner or a decor person just going by the portal. They would definitely want to sort of meet that person and see how their decor was like. They will never hire a caterer based on a portal. So you know, it is just, I think, convenience. Some people require that. They're like, you know, TK photography is not one of my top 10. I'll just go to a portal and quickly, you know, it's like that.
What are the common myths about destination weddings? You know, everyone feels ki yaar destination wedding hai to it's like a grand affair, you know, easy to do. So what are like hidden myths as a wedding photographer shooting destination weddings?
First myth is you get to go to cool destinations and you get to see new places. So wherever we have shot a destination wedding, unless we have asked the client that we want to overstay on our own expense and we'll take care of the return flights, they will never, you know, allow you to sort of be there. They'll be like, you know, this is the package that we have received, so you will never get to visit any destination otherwise. So that is the first myth. People feel it's a very, you know, chilled out place to be in. It is not. Secondly, people feel that it's less strenuous than having a banquet wedding. So it is not, actually. Local weddings have a deadline. You know, most of the people after 2, 3 or 4 o'clock, they go home and they get some rest, and then, you know, they get ready, they go to their jobs, and then in the evening they want to come back again after getting ready. So there's a huge gap in which you actually get to go back home, change clothes, rest, take your backups. In destination weddings, you know, the elders and the kids are having their two different parties. So once the ceremonies are over, the kids start with their after parties and craziness. That goes on till 4 or 5 in the morning. This is when the elders have already gotten enough rest. They would wake up at 9 and start with the ceremonies. So in a destination wedding, I mean, if it's a 3-day destination wedding, you can forget getting to sleep or doing anything. So it just becomes a never-ending loop. Thirdly, there is more effort involved in a destination wedding. People feel it's nice, it's easy. In every destination wedding, the crew requirement is reduced by the client. They don't want to spend a lot on travel. They don't want to spend a lot in accommodation and food and every other expense. So they make sure that the team is limited. Another myth is that you're getting a destination wedding, so you're getting big fat paychecks out of it. Most of the people who are paying for destination weddings, they don't want to spend a lot in photography and other things. Because they feel they've already overdone spending in the destination, travel and other things. So the costs of destination weddings is very competitive. It is sometimes lesser than what you would get in a city wedding. So I think these are the 3 or 4 main things that people need to understand.
What is your way of working with the couples? How do you make them comfortable?
Right. So, see, our typical scenario of a destination wedding is when a couple is hiring us. If the parents are hiring us, it becomes very difficult for us to sort of get into the space where the couple is comfortable enough to talk to us. So I'm looking at an ideal scenario wherein the bride and the groom have discussed with the families, contacted us, and they want to go ahead with us. So in this kind of a scenario, the bride has already seen my work. She has already been following my work for a while. So she's already comfortable with the kind of work that I do. She has probably seen my Instagram stories. She has seen my Facebook, my blog, and she knows what I do. So it is just a matter of telling them that, okay, what is your requirement and how are we going to sort of deliver that to you? There are couples who would come to us and they're like, oh, we are extremely shy. We do not go well in front of the camera. So, you know, it is just a matter of telling them that, okay, we will not do too many portraits if you don't want. We never enforce certain laws or anything that if you don't give us 2 hours of pre-wedding shoot or if you don't give us 1 hour during the ceremony, we are not going to come there or you're wasting your money. We do not act like, you know, we are the kings and queens and they are doing us a favor by hiring us. 50% of the couples that come to us, they tell us that we are very shy. We don't want a pre-wedding shoot. We never enforce that, you know, I want to do a pre-wedding shoot because it looks good on my portfolio or I will be able to send some work to the awards and stuff like that. We never do that. Get into a conversation by meeting them. If the meeting is not possible, we get on a Skype call, and now that we have discovered Zoom, it's going to be much easier. But that is typically how we sort of start conversing with them. We try to meet them before the wedding if possible, because if they are generally traveling to Delhi or some other place, they would like to sort of meet us. But most of the times it's more of an online conversation, understanding, exchanging emails, sending them new work and links of what we are doing, and understanding what they want or the kind of pictures they connect to. There are some times that couples don't want to have a conversation. So we never force it. There are times when people have just turned up at the destination and they're like, hey, we're a big fan of your work, but there has been no conversation in the 6-7 months. We are totally okay with that. We will never be like, you know, aap to baat hi nahi karte, hum aapki wedding kaise karenge. So we never do that.
Okay, so what gear you are using right now for your photography?
So I am using, for photography and films, we are using the Nikon Z6 and Z7. For lights, I'm using, my main is the AD200 Pro and the V1. Both of these are very easygoing lights. The AD200 is my favorite because of the high power and the fast recycle time. The Z6 and Z7 have been really nice to us. I mean, I love the skin tone colors that we get, and I am, you know, when I shifted to mirrorless, I had the option to sort of pick what system I wanted to go for. So I tried all the systems and then finally I decided to go with Nikon. And I've been with Z6 and 7 for, I think, almost 1 year now.
And what's your favorite focal length or a lens you use?
So these days I'm a big fan of the 35mm and the 2470 f2.8. On a Z6 and a Z7, the 2470 is super sharp. It is even as sharp as the 35 prime. The 35 is very versatile. It is a light lens, so I generally like to carry it in all weddings. But the 2470 is, it is crazy. I mean, the kind of sharpness it has, it can beat any other lens in terms of the color rendition and the quality.
The new S series lens, right?
I'm only on mirrorless, so I do not have access to the older FX series. So I've not even tried doing the FX series except for the 7200, because the 7200 was just launched. So that I have as the older FX model. I'm using it on the FTZ adapter. But other than that, all my lenses are right now the Z lenses. So we have the 35, 24, 50, 85, 7200, and the 1430, and of course the 2470.
So what presets you are using? I suppose you are using Lightroom, right, for editing?
Yeah, so we use a combination of Lightroom and Photoshop. We do our base edit in Lightroom. For every wedding, I create a unique preset. So that wedding has generally about 4 or 6 or 8 events. So I sit and go through the images and I create a preset for those images. Then I give my editors those presets. So all those, the entire set of those images for each event is given those specific presets. and then they come back to me, and then I sort of fine tune it, and then we take it to Photoshop. So that is typically our flow of work. But we generally don't use third party presets, we make our own.
When you are hiring a photographer or any team member, so what do you look for that some key attributes in a person while hiring?
So for interns and for people we are hiring, we have very different things that we measure. For interns, our primary factor is they need to be fan of our work. If they don't love our work, we don't want to sort of have them around us. So because when somebody wants to intern with us, we understand they don't have that particular skill set that, you know, they cannot become a direct employee. So we will sort of teach them different skills. We will sort of take them through different aspects, from marketing to photography to how to meet a client and stuff like that. And then see if they actually fit in, we would love to sort of take them on board. But if we are hiring a photographer or editor, we want that photographers and editors to be self-sufficient. We don't want them to sort of have a very particular style, which is Ramit Batra style, or they are like totally copying our work. We generally don't prefer that. We want people which have a fresh mindset, but we look for people who are independent and not the kind of people who will need a push every day that, you know, you have to do 200 edits, you have to do this or you have to do that. So that is what we look at. I like to work with people who are more independent than, the kind of typical employee material.
I guess we have been on for around more than an hour, I guess.
I guess so.
So thank you so much, sharing so much of valuable information. I hope photographers will get a lot of value out of it. And before we leave, why don't you share your website address and Instagram address so that people can go and check it out and follow you over there?
Sure. So my website is ramitbatra.com, and all my social handles are Ramit Batra Photography, including Facebook and Instagram.
So that's it for now. Okay, Ramit, thank you so much again. Bye-bye. I'll catch you on the other side. Bye.
Thank you so much, Navdeep. It was a pleasure.